Talk to me about the Sun Belt and what's making it so successful.
Well, the Sun Belt is in the right part of the country. You can coach. I was in the MAC, which is a good conference, and Midwest football is great. But football in the South is a religion. It's not just a pastime. It's a religion, and it's a 12-month favorite. And so we're in the right part of the country. And then I think because our heritage is Deep South, that we try to imitate the SEC in a lot of ways. We're not, in a smaller degree, we want to have facilities, we want to have all the bells and whistles with our programs, and our fans expect it, and we follow through. So I think that's the biggest thing. You're in the great part of the country. You have someone to look up to that you say, this is the kind of what the big boys do when they have the money. But we have expanded strategically to Virginia and West Virginia, which ties into our Coastal Carolina and our Appalachian State and those kind of teams to make a nice mix. Added Southern Miss over here, which strengthens our side. And so I don't see us getting bigger, because I think it's a great regional conference that represents the identity that the Sun Belt is.
And it does seem like college football, doesn't it?
Oh, it's college football. By all means, when this part of the country, there is a passion for college football.
I know we talked last year. You talked about the transfer portal and NIL. You talked about it up there on the podium. And how it's affected the landscape of college football. How it's affecting ULM. But when you talk about the guys looking at greener pastures, how much is your experience in being a part of those greener pastures, how much does that play in and giving them advice on what they should do?
I would hope it would make more, because I can give them honest, wise advice. Because I've been a head coach at NAI, Division III, Division II, 1AA, Group of Five, and Power Five. All six have been at a different level. And yes, the grass looks greener, but if you're third team in greener grass, you're still looking at somebody's rear end every day. And I think that's what they're not told, and that's what they're not going to believe. So you do the best job you can, but when a guy is ready to go, let him go and get somebody else.
Lane Kiffin, just a couple days ago at the SEC Media Days, talked about the NIL and the transfer portal being disastrous for college football. Yeah. Do you share his sentiments at all?
I go back a little further than Lane. Nothing is totally a disaster. We adapt and we adjust and we recognize it. A lot of things have changed dramatically, not just in my lifetime, but in watching my father deal with the changes in the 50s, the 60s, the 70s. Every decade since the 50s, we've had a Bowden head coach. And so this is another change. I don't like some of the things that the portal transfer, but I think if you asked a majority of the athletes, and they do matter, I think they like the idea that they can move as often as a coach. I think Lane, and I'm sure Lane, if he gets a better contract offer, he'll break that one and go to another one. And so will many coaches. No, I don't like portal, because it's not easy for me. NIL is more of a problem for us Group of Five coaches. We have a small pool of donors, and if they put their money in NILs, and which is the nature of the game now, we can't build facilities. We have no money to build, because we don't have so many guys. And so it makes it more difficult. But again, if you ask the players, do they like that new thing? If they're the ones that matter, they say yes. So there is a happy medium. There's no completely right or wrong. I just don't want us to lose the great things that college football has given to young men over the years. And not just a college degree, which I don't know that any of them are not getting that, but a college experience that they get. Just like when we went to all online rooms during the pandemic, half the classes in colleges are online anymore, because it's easier and it's cheaper. But to me, it's not as good an education, and portal transferring is not as good an educational experience.
And you talked so eloquently up there about knowing your fight song, representing your colors, meeting potentially your future partner. Talk to me about that.
Well, I mean, my buddies are my ball players. I mean, I don't care. I mean, I have a tweet right now with about 15 guys from Akron that they include me on, and they've been gone for 10 years. West Virginia, I played when Bobby Huggins played, my brother Tommy, and we still have that closeness to those people. I'm just afraid we're going to lose that as they jump from school to school. We're going to lose those bonds that last forever. And these are also the guys that come back and support your program as mentors to those young men, and Letterman clubs and things like that we fight so hard. I don't think we understand the difference this is going to happen to those type of areas. But overall, we adapt and we adjust. And I still think the fans love the game. The stadium is still a great game. There's just a few different variables involved.
You know, last year, you and I talked about LSU, Florida State.
Right.
The oranges.
I was there.
How do you feel in a year now removed, what do you feel about the job Brian Kelly did? And, of course, they're starting to open the season again against Florida State.
Well, Brian Kelly has shown why they hired him. He's a veteran. He knows you don't go to Notre Dame without understanding pressure. Now, LSU is political. It's a state like Auburn. You better know the background politics. And people say, oh, he's not from here. That guy went to Notre Dame. Whatever politics you think you got, they got more than you can ever imagine from Leahy to Rockne and all the great legends that coach there. Most of all, he knows how to coach football. I don't see any reason he can't continue to do exactly what he did. And with LSU's resources, the same reason Nick Saban went to LSU, the same reason he went to Alabama, is that you can win a championship there. They will give you what it takes to be successful if you know what you're doing. And I think, you know, Brian Kelly knows what he's doing.
Are you surprised, though, a coach from Notre Dame would choose to go outside of the Fighting Irish?
Well, there's a lot of Catholics in it. Come on, there's a lot of Catholics in southern Louisiana. Give me a break. I'm a Methodist, but I know there's a lot of Catholics down here.
Fantastic. Look, last question, Coach. Who's still the better coach? Does Tommy still think he's the better coach?
Oh, yeah. Tommy would put me a distant third to him and my dad. As Tommy would say, I'm the only Bowden that's never had a losing season. So, but you know what? He retired. He got out of the rat race, so he has no more argument anymore.
How does he feel, though, about seeing the programs he's left behind? What Tulane has done.
Oh, yeah.
He really kickstarted that off. And then at Clemson, that's got to be a lot of stuff.
Tommy never had a losing season. Tommy made a decision early in life, and we used to talk about it. He said, I'm going to coach till I'm 55, and then I'm getting out. And that was when we were in our 20s. And you know what? When he left Clemson, he was 55. And he's never looked back, never considered a job. And he does a lot of speaking at churches. He does a lot of FCA. He loves what he does. And that was just his plan. And it kind of filled out. But I think looking back, he played a key role at Tulane, and he played a key role at Clemson. He when it brought Dabo in, you know, to Clemson. And people that know Tulane football know the unbelievable success they had with Sean King. I was trying to tell my quarterback about Sean King and what they did with Rich Rodriguez there and Sean King and Tommy putting all that together.